Welcome to the Bullish Money YouTube channel. It is time for another unfiltered session, and the Dow Jones Industrial Average today, not really a great day, not necessarily a terrible day. It was down about 0.5%, and this is reflective of what's been going on in recent weeks. It's just not a whole lot of action going on in terms of the broad markets, but you see little jabs here and there, losing 0.2%, 0.3%. And all of those have basically accumulated so that what you see now in the technical charts is that you saw a recovery after Black Monday. You saw a pretty robust, it was a pretty robust recovery in the Dow Jones, in the S&P 500, in the NASDAQ. But then once it peaked, it started to, come back down, crumbling in little pieces. And so right now, with the Dow Jones sitting at 16,201 points, it basically gave up most of the gains made in that recovery. The critics have come out, the long hands of the markets have come out and basically said, look, the bears, they've made a premature argument. Our markets are robust. Our markets are still strong. We're still in a bull market. I say bullshit that we're still in a bull market. If you were still in a bull market, this consolidation wouldn't last this long. Plus, there's so much fundamental evidence, especially internationally, that suggests that there is no demand to prop up the speculative trading activity that has broadly occurred earlier this year. So a lot of that junk is starting to consolidate itself. You see, Caterpillar announced, a big industrial company, they announced that they're gonna have to cut 10,000 jobs. How is that supportive of a robust bull market? Again, it is bullshit. We're not in a bull market. We've now made the transition into a bear market. The evidence is quite clear. When you go from September 2014 to September 2015, you look at the year-over-year data, the technical data, you see that September last year, it started off in a very negative manner, and then it popped back up. But that when it popped back up, the rally didn't really sustain itself, and now we're right back down to where we started. So now the markets have neither gained nothing nor lost anything, but we're still in a very dangerous consolidation. We're in a bearish consolidation pattern, I've argued, and that can only mean that we have a very high probability that the markets will continue to move forward. I still stand by my argument that we're gonna lose about 10,000 points in the Dow Jones. Because you can't have major companies like Caterpillar announcing 10,000 jobs being lost. You have terrible announcements coming from companies like Hewlett-Packard. You see Qualcomm just take a dump in the markets. You've seen the technology sector itself broadly have just tanked. There's just companies just laying people off. And supposedly, we have improving unemployment rates. We have great jobs for everybody, supposedly. Yet we see that substantive jobs that are being provided by industry leaders, they continue to be decimated. And yet you have these jerk-offs on Wall Street, the apologists, continue to say, look, we gained 1% today. This is all the evidence that you need. I'm like, look at the bigger picture. You don't have to go back to 1950 or anything like that, but just look at the bigger picture here. Look at where we have gone from September of 2014 to September of 2015. That right there is evidence enough to suggest that we are weakening, that finally the fundamentals are realizing that, wait, there's no place to sell our products. There's no place to sell our services because we are absolutely getting demolished in terms of consumer sentiment and real demand. You guys want to criticize me. How about criticizing the government that tells you these lies? If you want to listen to lies, just go ahead and listen to the government. If you want to listen to truth, you listen to channels like this. The truth may be inconvenient, but it is the truth. We'll be right back. when you look at credit card companies, that tells you a lot in terms of the granular details of what's going on in the economy today. So I believe that right now, of the four major credit card companies, you have Visa, MasterCard, Discover, and American Express. So I believe that Visa is the leader in terms of market share, in terms of consumer transactions. So they've really got the, they've really managed to bottleneck the competition by providing a whole range of products and services that cater to a broad audience. And that of course means that they would have the lion's share of the market. Now, American Express, on the other hand, it's different from Visa and MasterCard, because these two companies, they're considered the everyday man's credit card. Whereas American Express caters to a higher, more affluent clientele. And you can tell that they cater to an affluent clientele, because one of the reasons why they offer better rewards. Simply put, their rewards are much better than the rewards of a Visa, a typical Visa or MasterCard. Plus you have perks if you're one of the ultra affluent people. You have, of course, the American Express Black Card, which right there is just culturally synonymous with American capitalism and exclusivity. But it's interesting when you look at the financial statements of Visa versus American Express, there are subtle differences. For example, Visa, their expenditures in terms of short-term investments, in terms of long-term investments, in terms of capital costs, business expenditures, they've all been steadily increasing. And along with the increases in those expenditures, of course, the cash flow or the amount of cash that they have on hand on the balance sheet, that has been dramatically declining over the past three fiscal years. Clearly, Visa and MasterCard, they have an incentive to invest in their advertising, to invest in opening up the markets. They're making a very, very big push, both domestically and internationally. They've been cutting into even market share for American Express, especially with the Costco deal that kind of collapsed with American Express. There's no longer an exclusive deal between Costco and American Express. So now that's going to be a major source of income, of revenue for Visa and MasterCard, because now they can just come in and take some more market share from American Express. Why not? I mean, Visa is really the credit card of the people, whereas American Express, again, is for rich people. Now, when you look at the financial statements for American Express, you'll notice that their cost of revenue actually has declined, and pretty dramatically, over the past three fiscal years. And that, of course, means that the gross profit margin has steadily increased over the past 3 years. In terms of cash expenditures, they don't really spend that much money when you look at the balance sheet. They continue to be cash rich and to promote a cash rich management style. So they really haven't made the kind of investments that a Visa or MasterCard have been making. And that's very interesting when you combine those discrepant strategies with what has been going on in the technical markets. You see that Visa and MasterCard, they have very, very similar technical postures. Their share price has been steadily rising since the onset of the Great Recession. But recently, along with other companies, blue chip companies in the S&P 500, they've been declining, and they've met a lot of upside resistance, and they've been trying to recover some of the losses that they've incurred in the August sell-off, but they have failed, just pretty much like the Dow Jones Industrial Average. They've failed to beat that upside, that upper resistance ceiling. American Express is no different. The trajectory of American Express shares is likewise bearish. But the main difference here is that American Express shares have been bearish for quite a long time, much longer than MasterCard or Visa. In fact, the bearishness in MasterCard and Visa just started recently, whereas American Express, you can argue, has been bearish for a year, probably over a year. It's interesting because people talk about the robustness of the bull market in the broad markets, in the Dow, in the S&P 500, yet you have a major player in American Express, which caters to very rich clientele. Their shares, their market capitalization has been taking a brutal hit month after month after month. They've been declining well in advance of MasterCard and Visa, and you gotta wonder, what is that all about? See, I think that's a major concern, and that's another major form of evidence as to why we are entering into a broad bear market. Because if rich people, if affluent people in this country are starting to scale back their consumer spending, how is that going to translate? You think that poor people, that the middle class, are now going to spend as much as the rich? No. The rich are scaling back. Now, there is a point to say that maybe MasterCard and Visa, they're making their investments, they're making their advertising, they're making their inroads into the, you know, the poor people, the middle class people, and giving them easier access to credit. Maybe that's true, and maybe that will inspire consumer spending for the poor and the middle class. But if that is successful, if that strategy is successful, that would be even more problematic for the broad economy, because you can't have the poor and the middle class get into further debt in order to make up for the lack of spending by the affluent people, by the affluent members of our country. You can't do that. I mean, if the rich that can afford to buy discretionary items, if they're not buying anymore, how is that any safer for the middle class and for the lower class to then take up the slack? American Express, I believe, when you look at the share price, when you look at the share trajectory of American Express, I think that is emblematic of the craziness, of the lunacy that is going on in the markets today. And I think that the fact that it's declining so harshly from its peak suggests that the people with the most information, the affluent people, the people with access to all kinds of data, to the best brokers, to the best analysts, those guys are getting out. The people that know better, they are getting out. They are concerned. If they're concerned, you should be concerned too. We should all be concerned. And that, for anyone to say that we're not in trouble, that the bull market is still going on, that the economy is robust, that America is the best house in the neighborhood, you know, I mean, if there's any instance of normalcy bias, it'll be right here. It'll be right here. When you got rich people, they're saying, no, we've had enough. And then now the big conglomerates, the MasterCards and the Visas, are trying to push poor middle-class people into taking up the slack. That, I would say, is a very big problem. That is more incentive to be concerned and to get out. Thanks again for watching another episode of the Bullish Money YouTube channel. Be sure to subscribe and also check us out on our social media network under the hashtag Bullish Money.